De-extinction has been making headlines recently with claims that the dire wolf has returned. But has it really? At first, I didn't think I would have much to say about it. But the more I looked into it, the more I realized how much this story deserves a deeper look. So this week, I've swapped out my scheduled video to talk about what's really going on. De-extinction. Is it possible? Or more relevantly, did it just happen? The media are calling it a scientific resurrection, but as always, the truth is more complex. As usual, check the description for a document with the sources for research I found useful and the images I used. Most people know dire wolves from Game of Thrones, or as staple monsters in fantasy games like Dungeons and Dragons, but long before fiction, they were real. Scientifically known as Enocyandyrus, dire wolves roamed North and South America during the last ice age, disappearing about 10,000 years ago. Despite their pop culture portrayal as giant wolves, they were only slightly larger than modern grey wolves, topping out at about 68 kilograms for their largest subspecies. Although grey wolves are their closest living relatives, genetic studies show they diverged over 5 million years ago. In fact, it is now believed that some poorly known extinct South American species may have been even closer relatives. But as they are no longer around either, the grey wolf is the closest we have to work with. So, how similar were dire wolves and grey wolves? Think of them less like cousins and more like distant relatives from another branch of the family tree. Dire wolves were stronger, with broader shoulders and a greater bite force. So, why talk about this now? On the 8th of April 2025, biotech company Colossal announced the birth of three genetically engineered wolf pups designed to resemble dire wolves. You might know Colossal from their other de-extinction projects, the woolly mammoth, the thylacine, the dodo. We have even talked about them on this channel before with their work on thylacines, but this is the first time we've heard about their work on dire wolves. The announcement went viral. My personal favourite reaction? Jurassic World's X account posting the Time magazine cover with the caption, "We see no possible way this could go wrong." Classic. But behind the jokes and the headlines, some important questions need to be asked. Questions that have always surrounded de-extinction, but now feel especially urgent. How did they do this? Are the pups really dire wolves? What's next for them? And finally, what's next for us? Let's start with the first one. How? The scientists extracted ancient DNA from two dire wolf fossils, a 13,000-year-old tooth and a 72,000-year-old skull. Even that is impressive considering how fragile DNA is. DNA breaks down over time with a half-life of about 521 years. That means after 521 years, only 50% of the original DNA will remain. After 6.8 million years, it is gone entirely. But even before that, environmental exposure to heat, water, or oxygen can destroy it much faster. That's why Jurassic Park is fiction. But dire wolves? Much more recent, around 10,000 to 125,000 years old. So recovering usable DNA is difficult, but not impossible. Still, that ancient DNA was far from complete. So scientists compared the fragments they had with the genomes of modern canines, grey wolves, jackals, foxes, to identify genes linked to key traits, broader shoulders, increased muscle mass, strong jaws and thick white fur. They made 20 edits across 14 different genes in grey wolf embryos, essentially inserting some dire wolf-like traits into a modern framework. These embryos were then cloned and implanted into domestic dog surrogates. The first pups, Romulus and Remus, were born on the 1st of October 2024. A third, Khaleesi, was born on the 30th of January 2025. The names alone give you a sense of how deeply this story is wrapped in both mythology and pop culture. So, are these pups actually dire wolves? Not really. With only 20 edits in their genome, they're still 99.9% grey wolves, just tweaked to display more dire wolf-like traits. That leads to an interesting philosophical question. How many edits would it take for them to stop being wolves and start being dire wolves. But even that misses a deeper issue. Let's say, hypothetically, scientists recreated a 100% accurate direwolf genome. Would that animal be a direwolf? I'd argue no, not entirely. Even if it looked identical, it wouldn't behave like a direwolf. Behavior isn't just genetic, it's learned. Wolves are highly social animals. They learn how to hunt, communicate, and survive from parents and their pack. Without a direwolf society to grow up in, a recreated pup wouldn't truly know how to be one. This is the classic nature versus nurture debate. Editing DNA gives us the nature, but nurture is missing. No environment, no community, no ancestral memory. And then there's the physical appearance. For example, the white fur. That's based on genetic inferences and assumptions. Partly because direwolves lived during the Ice Age, and animals in cold climates often evolve pale coats for camouflage. But we don't know what colour they were. Pigments don't survive fossilisation, so we're guessing, even if it's an educated guess based on genetic markers. And to be fair, researchers did analyse pigment-related genes, and the evidence does suggest a pale coat. But it's still not confirmation. And the fur is just one example. There are likely many other traits where we're relying on best guesses. I realise I might sound overly critical. That's not my intent. I'm sceptical, yes, but also amazed. This is a genuine technological breakthrough, and it opens some incredible doors. We'll get to that later. But for now, let's keep answering the questions I posed earlier. What about the pups? What happens to them now? As an animal lover, this was one of my first concerns. Will they spend their lives in labs, be put on public display in a zoo, or, more worryingly, be released into the wild? Right now, we don't know. The researchers haven't made any public statements about long-term plans. I'd assume their priority is keeping the pups safe and healthy, but they won't stay pups forever. And this leads to an ethical dilemma. Keeping them in labs or enclosures might feel restrictive, but releasing them into a world they're not evolved for could be worse. I joked earlier about Jurassic Park, but let's bring in the quote that always stuck with me. Ian Malcolm said,
"You stood on the shoulders of geniuses to accomplish something as fast as you could, and before you even knew what you had, you patented it and packaged it and slapped it on a plastic lunchbox, and now you're selling it. You want to sell it. Well,
I don't think you're giving us our due credit. Our scientists have done things which nobody's ever done before."
Yeah, but your scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could that they didn't stop to think if they should.
This project feels like a moment where that question really matters. It's been over 30 years since that movie came out. Surely someone's had time to think of an answer. I couldn't find any official statement on what Colossal plans to do with these animals, but they clearly have bigger ambitions. Their goal is to have woolly mammoth calves by 2028. I just hope they're thinking ahead, not just about how to bring extinct species back, but how to give them lives worth living. So, what's next? Not for the pups, but for the technology itself. Dire wolves went extinct around 10,000 years ago. Since then, the Earth has changed drastically. New predators have taken over, the climate has shifted, and their primary prey is long gone. Today's Americas are a different world from the one dire wolves once roamed. But what if we moved closer to the modern era? Take the thylacine, the so-called Tasmanian tiger. The last known one died in 1936, though some believe wild populations may have survived into the 1980s. Either way, we're pretty sure they're gone now. But could we bring them back? Colossal is trying, but they haven't made as much progress as with the dire wolves. Still, I think there's a stronger argument to be made here. The thylacine vanished less than 100 years ago, and Tasmania hasn't changed as drastically as, say, the Pleistocene world of the dire wolf. Unlike mainland Australia, where thylacines were outcompeted by dingoes, Tasmania never had dingoes. The apex predator there today is the much smaller Tasmanian devil. So there might be room for the thylacine to return. It's a possibility at least. But we have to be careful. Reintroducing a predator to an ecosystem that's adapted to life without it for a century could have unintended consequences. There's a lot of research and a lot of caution required before that could ever be justified. Living in New Zealand, I know firsthand What happens when you introduce species where they don't belong? Australia knows too, just ask the cane toad. Even if the environment seems ready, there's still the nurture problem. How would a lab-born thylacine know how to be a thylacine? Would instincts be enough? Or would it mimic its surrogate, creating a behavioural hybrid? That brings us to a challenge unique to marsupials. What surrogate would you use? Dire wolves have grey wolves. Thylacines were marsupials, related to kangaroos, wombats, and the Tasmanian devil. Their closest living relative is the numbat, but that species diverged from thylacines over 34 million years ago. That's a huge evolutionary gap to overcome. Still, the tech has potential far beyond extinct species. What about endangered animals that still exist today? This is where I see real promise. The nature versus nurture dilemma vanishes when the species is still alive. You can have the edited animals raised by members of their own kind, and we already have access to their genomes, or can sequence them far more easily than fossilized DNA. With that, we could create genetically edited animals to reinforce fragile populations or even restore lost genetic diversity after a bottleneck. Bottlenecks, when a population crashes and then recovers, drastically reduce variation. Gene editing tools could help reintroduce diversity artificially. But even this idea raises questions. The technology is still expensive, though that's likely to change. But with over 10,000 species listed as critically endangered by the IUCN, and 81 more listed as extinct in the wild, who do we help first? Do we prioritise the charismatic megafauna, the orangutans, the forest elephants, the pygmy sloths? Probably. But what about the Barbosa de-espadan, known scientifically as Arion luise? That's a critically endangered roundback slug found in a single lake in Spain. I had never heard of it before I checked the red list. Would anyone spend millions to save that slug? Probably not. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't use the technology at all. It just means we need to use it responsibly and strategically. And some of that work has already started. Let's go back to Colossal. Yes, them again. They're using their dire wolf experience to help the red wolf, Canis rufus, a critically endangered species found only in North Carolina. The so-called red ghost wolves they're developing have genetics closer to ancestral red wolves, with the goal of restoring genetic diversity to a population that's down to just 20 or 30 individuals. That's a smart use of the technology, but it still doesn't fix the root problem. Because if we use gene editing to rescue species without addressing the causes of their decline, habitat destruction, climate change, hunting, pollution, then we're just delaying the inevitable. Yes, extinction is a natural process. It's been happening for millions of years. But right now, humans are accelerating it at an unprecedented rate. And if we're going to play God with nature, we should probably start by playing the role of guardian. There's one last question I've touched on, but carefully avoided diving into until now. Should we do this? Is it right for humans to play God? I don't think I'm the one to answer that. And honestly, I don't think anyone has a simple answer. I've raised concerns throughout this video, but I've also highlighted the hope this technology brings. Still, none of that gets to the heart of the moral debate. The ancient Greeks had a word for this, hubris. Today, we use it to mean arrogance, but to them, it was deeper. Hubris meant defying the natural order, stepping beyond what humans were meant to do. And in their stories, the gods always responded, usually through Nemesis, the goddess of divine retribution, who struck down those who overreached, restoring balance. Maybe I'm just letting my love for classical history creep into the science, but I think the comparison fits. We have the tools now, but using them responsibly is everything. Unfortunately, one of the main tools we have to guide responsible use, the law, isn't great at keeping up. Technology moves fast. Legislation? Not so much. Take New Zealand, where I live. The Privacy Act of 1993 was only updated in 2020 to reflect digital realities. The Harmful Digital Communications Act didn't pass until 2015, years after the cyberbullying and revenge porn it was designed to protect against were already widespread. Even now, online hate speech, copyright issues, and digital regulation are stuck in legal grey areas. And those are just the laws that exist. When it comes to genetic technologies, there are a few international agreements in place, like the Codex Alimentarius and the Cartagena Protocol, but they mostly focus on genetically modified food or international transport of genetically modified organisms. The laws that govern things like de-extinction? Practically non-existent. And what little does exist varies wildly between countries. So, depending on legislation to guide the ethical use of this tech, that's a shaky foundation. Which means it falls to scientists, institutions, and yes, us, the public, to question, debate, and decide what kind of future we're creating. Dire wolves may not walk the earth again, yet. But we're standing at the dawn of a new era. One where extinction might not be forever, and nature gets a helping hand from science. There are so many questions still unanswered, but the potential? It's massive. If used carefully, this technology could help build a more sustainable world, and maybe even slow the extinction crisis already underway. Next time, we'll return to the video I'd originally planned for today, an exploration of the most indestructible little weirdos on Earth, the tardigrades, aka water bears. In the meantime, let me know in the comments, should we bring back the past? Or protect what we still have? Can we do both? Like, subscribe, and tell me what you think. I am certain this technology is just getting started.